people clad in black, lots of punks and astonishing hairdos and stovepipe pants and winkle pickers and chains and things.
You know, the Sherazade and Café Mondo and a few other places were little gathering halls for elderly gentlemen to come on Sundays, have coffees and discuss the world politics.
There was these really interesting guys that were studying manuscripts at the State Library about what, I don't know, but that was all they wanted to do in life, living in a room, yeah. People painting in rooms, overlooking the sea, paying $10 a week for the view, yeah. That's what St Kilda was.
Seemed like the Ghoulies. It seemed like it was so far away and so foreign because Doncaster was such a new place and this was such an old suburb. And so that, I guess, is my first impression, its age.
My earliest memory of St Kilda was that my grandfather had a part-time job at Luna Park when all the men had to be properly dressed. It was like fantasy land, you know, hats and epaulettes. And he got two or three tickets a week for his family, and my elder brother and I were sent up Saturday morning, and we got one ride on Dodgem cars, one ride in the water thing, monsters coming out of the water, and then he took us to the waffle stand. They made fresh waffles, and his mate would make us two secret waffles, which he didn't have a pass for, and we had to run out and eat them in the gardens.
And I remember him and his girlfriend one day came to me and said, "We'll take you up, you know, because I'm this new boy in town. We'll take you." I said, "Where are we going?" We're going to St Kilda. We'll show you St Kilda." This is 1982. Because that was the place, you know, when you wanted to. They had that Albion Hotel, which is a, you know, established hotel in Carlton, student used to go to. We had all those things around there, but St Kilda was for nightlife. That's where you go.
Well, my cousin and I were going to Teachers College at Monash University, and we shared a flat in St Kilda. I suppose cheap rent, by the sea, just loved the culture that we came to live in. And it was far, far away from Monash, which seemed very important at the time too.
Broadly, St Kilda had multiple despoyers, and they all kind of intermingled, making up the uniqueness.
I left them there, then I said to the Chris, "I'll go and explore." And I found my way down to the Esplanade, the bottom Esplanade, and then went to the pier and walked the pier. And as soon as I did that, I said to myself, "Fuck, what am I doing in Carlton?"
Well, St Kilda in those days was quite diverse and much poorer than it is today. And there were great mobs of Aborigines everywhere in all the parks, especially Katani Gardens.
A lot of Polynesian, South Sea Island transsexuals lived here. We had a transsexual nightclub called Like Girls. You had this multiple amount of mammoth looking characters in lipstick walking around the street, and no one bothered them.
There were lots of old people and lots of artists and students and musicians because rent was really cheap and the housing was all a bit decrepit. And there were still little fruit shops on Fitzroy Street and family businesses everywhere.
Sunday morning, walking down Ackland Street as a 20-year-old was like being on a movie set out of something, you know, a Berlin movie. It was just so sharp. You'd have groups of well-dressed Jewish men outside one shop. You'd walk to the next, another group, up to 30, and then a bit further, another group. But what I noticed is, as I passed the first group, I was hearing Polish. The next were the Germans, and the next were the Hungarians. And the hands were going.
It was much less homogenized. Things like the sea baths were still there in all their decrepit glory. And we'd go swimming there. The shark net had been ripped away. No sharks came in. And there was this fabulous half-destroyed walls and cubicles, no roof. It was beautiful.
The Sea View Ballroom, I believe, or one of the, and that still had bands on. Prince of Wales was still a grunge place. And you see, and there was much more live music, much more live music.
It was a great hotbed of crime at the time, chopper raids and so forth. And so all the drug culture was here. It wasn't in Richmond like it is now, or it wasn't as spread out. It was really here. And there were funny nightclubs with a whole host of people you wouldn't want to meet that weren't actually that bad.
And Ackland Street was this really kind of, it could be Vienna, it could be Berlin, it could be Paris. It was sophisticated. Nothing in Melbourne. Then you'd walk around to Fitzroy Street, and then, my God, I've turned up on another film set. It was like a film set, but this time they were shooting, Scorsese made the film Taxi Driver.
Most flats were occupied by some poor musician or a writer. I was the illegal migrant living in one of those flats, sharing it with a friend of mine.
The smell from Ackland Street, baguettes, coffee, flowers, stale frying oil, dim sims in every second shop, just the whole drug addicts trying to, you know, bot some money on the corner of Grey Street.
But there were also lots of cheap studios, art studios, because there were big cavernous empty houses, so there was a lot of that too, College of the Arts types.
And there was girl after girl after girl. They started about 12 o'clock in the day, but then I noticed what happened is as Robe Street became bought out by the yuppies, the gentrifiers, they somehow did some deals with the council to sort of move the girls across Barker Street into more factory warehouse area.
And it was easy to be on the dole then too. So there were a lot of unemployed people who could afford to be unemployed and still live the rock and roll lifestyle.
So if I was a low-income tenant in the 70s, looking somewhere in Melbourne to hide away or be myself, I'd choose St Kilda, because St Kilda, of all the inner suburbs, was the highest rental area, highest in Australia.
It served this purpose as well, as an entertainment centre for young men and young women to come and let it loose, go to the Esplanade, get drunk, and take drugs and go home. And that, probably that reputation, kept those establishment people away and the rents down. But I knew from my Mandalay experience, and I knew it didn't make sense, that that had to change. And if I had money, I should have bought things. Everything should have been bought then, and some people obviously did. And so the change was inevitable, and it happened. Now, is it to the better or to the worse? That's not, you know, it's change is change.
And then I witnessed the opening of the Bastion of Cool, the Greasy Joe's, followed by the Dogs Bar in the late 80s. And then I noticed people flooding into St Kilda, but they didn't look like the normal people who flooded into St Kilda. These were cool people. These were cool people that had Saabs, yeah, and had body treatments. Yeah, they were the cool, yeah, for the Dogs Bar. And then you got bar after bar after bar, so that Ackland Street looks like a suburban mall and Fitzroy Street looks like something contaminated South Yarra. Yeah. In the early 70s, St Kilda was had the structure, physical structure, to support the bohemians. It had cheap rental flats because no one wanted to live in St Kilda, hundreds of them. It had rooms for people who just lived for years and years in that same room. Those things don't exist. You don't get cheap rentals anymore because they're either being sold to private, what we call the new people, or investors have got them wanting the maximum rent. The so-called bohemian St Kilda actually doesn't exist any longer. It's in the new people's heads, it's in their dreams, what I call their junkyard of dreams, right? And it's what they try to save. There's a few token bohemians around, but they're just tokens. They're not the temperature anymore. They're the oddities, and they're vulnerable. Any minute, their place could go. The last rooming house could go. The last cheap block of flats could go. All I hear is St Kilda is different. St Kilda is so different. It's not like a suburb anywhere else. It's different, and we have to save this difference. But really, what this is a class politics. It's people expressing their own self-worth by saying, I'm different, I'm distinctive. And we don't want another Chadstone in St Kilda. But my grandmother lives in Chadstone. She keeps saying, what's the matter with Chadstone?